Hello everyone, Taki here. In this video, we're going to take a look at the emulation performance of the new RK3588 chip. It's been almost 6 years since the release of the last flagship processor from Rockchip, so when the RK3588 was announced back in 2019, a lot of people were left waiting to see the improvements that Rockchip could bring to the open source market. On paper, the RK3588 has decent specs. It has four Cortex A76 cores, which are much older tech now than they were back in 2019, but they do bench very high for a processor in this segment. This should translate into better emulation in high-end systems that rely on raw CPU power. On the opposite side of this, they paired the CPU with a mid-range, current-gen Mali GPU. Mali GPUs have a bad reputation in the emulation community for good reason, so expectations for the 3588 are not high. Hopefully, you will leave this video as impressed as I am after you see the full range of what this processor can do. If you enjoy content like this, don't forget to subscribe to the channel. We are going to jump around a bit in this video, but I want to start off with some 2D emulation. Here we have Genesis with the Genesis Plus GX wide core in RetroArch. Continuing with this, we have SNES with the BSNES HD core. This core requires a lot of power to run well, and the RK3588 has enough power to run Mode 7 games at 1x resolution in widescreen mode. Typically, I would use a standalone application for Saturn emulation because they tend to have better performance, but that is not an option for us with the Yaba Sanshiro app crashing on load. As you can see, the performance is pretty bad with RetroArch, but we can improve this by manually setting the clock speeds to max. I'll talk more about this when we get to Switch emulation. Without any fuss or need to change the clock speeds, we have amazing performance in Dreamcast with the Flycast core. I have the rendering resolution set to 1080p, and we're using widescreen hacks. This is the best Dreamcast performance on a Rockchip processor that I've ever seen, and it rivals other well-known processors that I've already reviewed. I'll point out that I'm using a standard PC fan over my RK3588 now, instead of the smaller one that comes with the board. The bigger fan has the same cooling efficiency, but it makes significantly less noise. It can keep temps under or around 30 Celsius, no matter what I do. Strengthened. 3DS emulation is pretty garbage on Android, so I did not have any big expectations that we would see decent gameplay with a CPU and GPU combination like we have in the RK3588. We do have the power to push the rendering resolution up pretty high for some 3DS games, but some of the popular titles like the Zelda games have annoying graphical issues. OpenGL performance is actually not something that the Mali G610 does well, so you are looking at a worst case scenario when we are using an emulator like Citra to run our games. Vulkan tends to be much better with this processor, and that's not something that I'm used to seeing in my tests. I'll point out that you might hear some slight audio crackle in the footage in this section. This is caused by my screen capture and is not present on the chip itself.
Power is nothing compared to the bonds we forged. hold the L or R button while turning to move left or right quickly. Press the L.
The Skyline emulator and the team behind it are making a lot of progress recently. After seeing how well this runs on weaker chips, I was very eager to test out Sonic Mania on the RK3588. I was surprised to see that the performance was as bad as it is here. We're sitting at 17 FPS, which is not playable by any stretch, but I did notice that our clock speeds were very low for a system that is this demanding. I was going to leave things here and use this footage in this video as is because the game technically does run. After filming this, I was left wondering what would happen if I were to go back and manually change the clock speeds for the GPU and CPU to their maximum levels. After doing that, my FPS peaks at 40 in some areas, with 37 acting as an average baseline. This is a big improvement over the stock experience. Now let's start checking out PlayStation emulation with the DuckStation emulator. I've set this to 5x native resolution, and I have PGXP turned on. We can go higher than 5x if we manually change our clock speeds, but not all games will work at those higher resolutions, so I'm going to stick with 5x for 1080p. With this processor, we have a lot of options when it comes to N64 emulation. If you like to tinker, you can use the parallel core in RetroArch to fix some issues with some N64 games, but I like to use Mupin 64 Plus core with the 1080p wide-adjusted setting. The games look amazing like this, and it's also a huge improvement over the more popular ROC chip processors like the RK3326 and the 3399. People judge PSP emulation based on the God of War games, and this chip does not disappoint. We are using the superior Vulkan backend, which allows us to upscale games to 5x native resolution with decent performance. We could go lower than this to smooth out some areas, but the system would not be using its full potential. Now, let's look at PS2 emulation. I got a comment on my last video saying that this chip would be bad for PS2 emulation because it has a Mali GPU. Thankfully, this is not the case. This emulator has a Vulkan renderer that we can use, and it works very well on this chip. If we were limited to OpenGL, the experience would be bad, so the recent improvements to EtherSX2 are on full display with our oddly configured RK3588.
Let's go. You probably don't remember, but we've met. I've changed your diapers before, you know?
Let's move on to GameCube emulation with the Dolphin emulator. As you might expect by now, we're using the Vulkan backend, and it works well with this chip. I've seen FPS improvements as high as 50% going from OpenGL to Vulkan for the same game, and that is something that I've never seen on other processors. This footage was recorded after I found out that the default CPU and GPU governor is leaving some performance on the table, so all of these games are using maximum clock speeds. Finally, let's look at Wii performance with the Dolphin emulator. I'm using the official emulator and the MMJR1 build for these games, but you could use the official build for everything if you want. As a bonus, I want to showcase emulation and gaming performance under Linux. Starting with DuckStation, you can see that our FPS is pretty garbage. This is again due to the CPU and GPU controls. If we manually change the clocks, the performance improves. We are limited to OpenGL under Linux, so we are leaving a lot on the table with the RK3588. I was surprised to see that even things like 2D PSP games are too demanding with the current software on offer and the OpenGL drivers that we have. We can improve the situation by boosting our clocks, but most of the PSP library is completely out of reach. For anything that you would want to do under Linux, you are going to be better off by manually changing your clock speeds, or you will have to lower your graphical options to the bare minimum. This board can boot an OS from an SD, so I can comfortably leave Linux on my SD and stick with Android on the internal storage for better emulation performance. Anyway, that's going to be it for this video. Let me know your thoughts down below on the RK3588. I can't wait until we see this processor make its way over to some gaming consoles and gaming handhelds, because it is a beast. Subscribe if you enjoyed this content, and feel free to check out my first look video on the RK3588 if you missed it. Happy gaming, everyone. Taki out.